Talk fast.
Okay, is everyone ready? Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
As I said yesterday, what I'd like to do over the next few days is begin by talking about a vow. Talking about vow and then ritual. Looking at building blocks of ritual, at least in the Soto tradition, and looking at ritual itself in a broad way, and I think that's partly what we'll talk about today. Considering repentance as an aspect of ritual, as an aspect of vow, and this afternoon, because Adam Strukai is coming up, so I think that if we together look at the Jukai ceremony, there are a lot of the elements of ritual that we can see as independent and interdependent in that ceremony. So today I'd like to kind of talk through the ceremony and the various pieces of it, and then tomorrow I think we're going to go into the Zendo, possibly in the morning, for sure in the afternoon. In the morning, talk about the Zendo as a sacred space, and what are the things that are in the Zendo? What is it that wakes us up to the fact that it's a sacred space? What does that mean? What does sacred mean to us? And by looking at that, over the long term, what I'd like you to think of is like, how do we create and carry around that space with us? And then tomorrow afternoon, we can actually start pieces of rehearsal towards the ceremony. Does that make sense? Good. So where I'd like to begin, you've been sort of dipping in and out of living by vow, right? And somebody may have done this. You don't have to get very far into the book to, let's see, yeah, page, it's the first page of the preface. So Shohaku-san is talking about the temple, Katagiri Roshi's temple, Minnesota Zen Meditation Center on Lake Calhoun, which is called Koan-zan Ganshoji. Koan-zan means cultivating the clouds. It's a mountain. Zan is the mountain. Koan is cultivating the clouds, and the mountain cultivating the clouds. Ganshoji, which is means living by vow, and something that Katagiri Roshi said that's very powerful, very useful, I think. He talks about one of the definitions of bodhisattva, and he says, ordinary people are those who live who are pulled by their karma, which I think is what Joshin was talking about last night. Ordinary people are those who live who are pulled by their karma. Bodhisattvas are those who live led by their vows. It's your choice. It's each of our choices, and it's our opportunity to help each other with that vow. So to begin with, what I'd like to do is read a vow. How many of you are familiar with Dogen's Ehei Kosu Hotsu Ganma? Oh good, not many. This is Dogen's vow. It's his vow of practice. And I think it's really beautiful. it's part of, I'll just say, it's something that we chant during the, in my experience, we chant it during the transmission process every day. And I think it's part of the liturgy at San Francisco Zen Center now.
Before Dharma.
Yeah. Oh, before Dharma talks. Mm-hmm. That's good.
The whole thing?
Yeah, we'll be the whole thing.
No, no, I'm asking Christine.
The whole thing.
Yeah, they chant the whole thing before Dharma talk.
So let's read it out loud. Ehe kosu kotsugamo.
I just want to clarify, I don't mean like on Wednesday when the speaker is there, but part of the practice period is chanted
before every talk.
Yeah.
We vow
with all beings from this life on throughout countless lives to hear the true Dharma, that upon hearing it, no doubt will arise in us, nor will we lack in faith, that upon meeting it, we shall renounce worldly affairs and maintain the Buddha Dharma, and that in doing so, the great earth and all living beings together will attain the Buddha way. Although our past evil karma has greatly accumulated, indeed being the cause and condition of obstacles in practicing the way, may all Buddhas and ancestors who have attained the Buddha way be compassionate to us and free us from karmic effects, allowing us to practice the way without hindrance. May they share with us their compassion, which fills the boundless universe with the virtue of their enlightenment and teachings. Buddhas and ancestors of old were as we in the future shall be Buddhas and ancestors. Revering Buddhas and ancestors, we are one Buddha and one ancestor. Awakening Bodhi mind, we are one Bodhi mind. Because they extend their compassion to us freely and without limit, we are able to attain Buddhahood and let go of the attainment. Therefore, the Chan Master Lumiya said, those who in past lives were not enlightened will now be enlightened. In this life, save the body, which is the fruit of many lives. Before Buddhas were enlightened, they were the same as we. Enlightened people of today are exactly as those of old. Quietly explore the farthest reaches of these causes and conditions, as its practice is the exact transmission of a verified Buddha. Confessing and repenting in this way, one never fails to receive profound help from all Buddhas and ancestors. By revealing and disclosing our lack of faith and practice before the Buddha, we melt away the root of transgressions by the power of our confession and repentance. This is the pure and simple color of true practice, of the true mind of faith, of the true body of faith.
Some reason it's just the emotion of that really hits me this morning. There's a lot in here. What's being given to us, what our weakness is. It's very moving. So you can have those copies. I thought I would tell you, talk about this a little and then discuss it, because I think there's, usually there are questions about this. I've got enough fairly strong discussion about this on the way to the airport yesterday with one of my Dharma brothers, you know, around the questions like, oh, Buddhas of old are the same as we. You know, it's like, oh, really? So, just let me give you a little background. I have not been able to find the provenance of this piece, and I've asked a bunch of people who would know. It seems to be among Dogen's writings, but it doesn't fall into one, any one particular locus. Do you know? I mean, I think Reb was
vague. It's not in the Shobogenzo, right?
No, no. Reb was vague about it. Tygen was vague about it. And I didn't have a chance to contact Shohakusar. But this, what it means, Ehe is Dogen's name, which means great peace. Koso is a posthumous title, mm-hmm. meaning founder.
Like Daiyosho?
Daiyosho means great teacher. Koso means founder. There are two founders of Soto Zen. Dogen is one, he's the Koso, and Keizan, Zenji, K-E-I-Z-A-N, is the other, and he's the Taiso, and I don't know what the distinctions of those are. But anyway, so that's Ehe Koso.
So it's not that he named himself, he didn't name
himself.
No,
it's a posthumous name.
And this, the
this
title then is posthumous.
Yeah.
Okay.
Gan is vow. So, you know, when we do the four bodhisattva vows, it's like Shigu Sei Gan, four sa, Sei Gan is four vows. And Mon is gate. So it's the gate
the vow
of vows.
Gate.
And Hotsu means something like universal. You know, it's like mm-hmm. the universal gate that all of us can enter. I think in the first paragraph where he says, he alludes to, there are quite a bunch of negatives there. That upon hearing it, no doubt will arise on us, which implies we have doubt. Nor will we lack in faith, which implies, oh, we lack in faith. And actually, he gets to that right at the end again. And that upon meeting it, we shall renounce worldly affairs, which he talks about quite a lot. Particularly, he talks a lot about it in his early work, Dogen, when he was mostly dealing with people who were in the world, and you know, who were struggling with figuring out how to have a balance between their practice life and their worldly life, as most of us are.
It would seem to me that it would be less dualistic if we would say, we shall renounce striving in worldly affairs rather than renouncing worldly affairs. You know what I mean?
Well,
clean.
Yes. It's a tricky question. How accurate are liturgical or textual offerings are, and how much we leave them in a form that may not fit us, but that provides a challenge for us. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, it raises the question, what does this mean? What does this mean for me to renounce worldly affairs? So this is always a conundrum, I think, as we're working with translated texts, because they're coming from a different context, and also a different set of beliefs and different set of principles, and we shouldn't assume that we are operating exactly from the same principles. Of course, he says we are, you know. As we get on with this. And I think this second paragraph, again, not to single out Joshin, but the second paragraph, although our past evil karma has greatly accumulated, indeed being the cause and condition of obstacles in practicing away. May all Buddhas and ancestors who have attained the Buddha way be compassionate to us and free us from karmic effects, allowing us to practice the way without hindrance. I think this is kind of what you were talking about. Interesting, again, the word is strong, past evil karma. And it happened that I just had a brief visit with Kazu Tanahashi the other day, and he's doing a book on the Zen chants. And we were talking about some of his translations. And, you know, I don't know what you all use, but in our repentance verse, we used to say, all my ancient twisted karma, and that was, some people didn't like that. So it's now, all my ancient tangled karma. But the real translation is evil. That's, you know, it's like calling a spade a spade. It's unwholesome. And, you know, there's unwholesome karma, there's wholesome karma, there is activity that is beyond karma, which is exemplified by zazen. It's non-karmic activity. Although,
we can
create some karma in there. We're very slippery. But essentially, and that's what, you know, that's what Dogen is talking about as zazen and as practice, and I think that's what Shohaku was talking about in Living by Vow, is that even if we are entering into, you know, patterns of thoughts in the context of our zazen, it's still, there's an activity that is beyond our conceptualization and beyond karma in that. But in this vow, there's an interesting, I feel, logical connection. He says, Buddhas and ancestors who have attained the Buddha way will be compassionate to us and free us from karmic effects. In the next paragraph, it says, may they share with us their compassion, which fills the boundless universe with the virtue of their enlightenment and teachings. And so I'm just curious what you think share their compassion means.
What does it mean to free us? I mean, what are we asking for? Asking to be freed. Have them free us.
Mm-hmm.
I think it means that when we can actually see the karmic effects in our lives, the tangled karma,
mm-hmm.
A compassion arises in us for ourselves or others that we may have affected. I think that's what it means.
But what do you mean, what do you understand the word compassion to mean?
Well, the word tenderness comes up to me. The word non-separation of this one and, you know,
a heart connection.
I think it's that we're actually sort of giving permission or asking that they provide us with whatever lesson we need to get over ourselves.
And what's interesting is a share, it's present tense.
Yeah. I think it's worse.
Not that they did it.
We're entering that relationship.
I was relating it back to the first paragraph that would help us to be free from doubt and faith, and I'm having a major problem with that first paragraph.
Well, let's come back to that. Let me make a suggestion about the word compassion. This is, you know, like what Suzuki Roshi said about enlightenment, you know, and somebody asked him, but he said, you may not like it.
Yeah.
And to me, you've been sort of talking around the center, which is, if they share their compassion with us, it means we're in for a load of hurt.
Mm-hmm.
Compassion means suffer with, feel the pain of. So if they're sharing their compassion with us, it's like, okay, this is what I signed up for. It's gonna hurt. Mm-hmm. And there's going to be fear. And so I want to be careful about, there's in the culture, we sort of soften these words and make them nice. But if we really think about what it feels like to be compassionate, I mean, there's something to the expression, breaks your heart.
Empathy.
Yeah. Empathy, empathy is, I was reading something, empathy is like some psychologists have seen this as a stage of compassion.
A stage.
Yeah, it was like empathy is the mechanism by which you actually, but it's previous to compassion. Compassion also has an active and transformational drift. That empathy may be just the initial feeling with. I don't know. I don't want to get too tangled up in that.
Well, I think it's good for us in a certain way to relate to this. And one of the things that I've been talking about is the tendency to dissociate from suffering. And that is an associative process. And everything we do is an associative process. So in this way, we're connecting with and allowing, dissolving that dissociation.
Right, and the very word, the calm in passion is with.
Yes.
And also just to say, we all know that Zazen can be a dissociative process.
Yeah, well, that's
not,
what
nobody,
we're
gonna... Nobody here, right?
Oh, yeah,
nobody
no,
here.
No.
You know, but that's not, that's exactly what this vow, it's the vow of association. And in the next, you know, in the next lines, this is a really powerful. Buddhas and ancestors of old were as we in the future shall be Buddhas and ancestors. So, come back to Paul, your difficulty with.
Well, I thought, two things came to me that I thought in some ways doubt was a driving force of Zazen and Zen, and I thought that we could have faith in ourselves, not in what someone else says. This reminds me too much of the Apostles' Creed. I want to rip it up and throw it away.
I can understand that.
But what's the Apostles' Creed?
It's a Catholic prayer that says I'm promised to believe in all these things that are not accessible to personal experience.
This may be related to that, but I was reading the May They Share With Us Their Compassion. It seems to me that they've shared their compassion in the creation of the lineage and a way of practice. And so to say, may they share with us their compassion could actually be saying, may we have the courage to face entering into this tradition.
Mm-hmm.
And so that it's not so much blind doubt, but the vow is, may I be courageous enough to enter into the stream which has been provided that allows one to face and transform suffering.
Yeah, I think that's right. You know, so in Japanese Buddhism, there's a there's a dualistic, if you will, framing of practice. Some of the Buddhist schools are seen as self-power schools. Zen is nominally a self-power school. And some of them, like Tendai, and the schools that flowed from that, Nichiren, Jodo Shinshu, are nominally other power schools. And I think that, and in this particular text, Dogen is kind of, he's bridging them. And this is tricky for us, I think. If I look around this room, I would venture that everybody has a background, has some religion of the book background, Christianity, Judaism, and that most of us, is there anyone here who has an active practice in those traditions?
If Mary Ellen was here, she
does. She
does, yeah.
Pretty much.
You know, and those are other power schools par excellence, except, you know, then you start looking at the Protestant Reformation and you have the whole split over faith and works, which is just another way of framing the same split. So a lot of us are really understandably uncomfortable with something that smacks of other power, which I think is what you're
trying. Yeah, that's exactly.
Right. So, but for me, what I thought over the years, because initially I had that perspective as well, and I'm sort of fleeing a highly dysfunctional Jewish background. And then there's the mystery. How did we get in this room? You know, it's like, yes, we had to drive here. We had to do a lot of shit, you know, but here we are, 10 or 11 of us in this room. And how we got here is completely beyond my understanding. And so I'm willing to admit kind of the mysterious working of, you could say, other power, or power beyond my understanding. And that's at least...
Well, could you also frame it as action beyond my awareness, karmically?
Yeah.
And so we don't have to have any notion of the mystic, because when you put it that way, it almost sounds mystical to me.
Right. Well, how I'm meaning it is mystical. How Dogen meant it, I don't know. You know, how literally that was the atmosphere that they breathed. You know, that was the culture that they were in, where they were critically examining, and he was very critical, and all the major religious figures of his time there in the early 13th century were reframing Buddhism in accord with what they thought worked. And but what their overall larger container of their vision of the working of the universe, it's I don't know it, you know, and we're not living it.
One of the books I brought down here to read while I was here was recommended by somebody, which is it's a book about the 12-step program that's kind of sacred recovery, like taking it beyond a particular addiction and being able to work the steps even if you don't identify as a particular addict. And the very first step, which is as far as I've gotten in this book, is I have no control. And all the different ways that that plays out, like, this is the first step. And that's what I can't help but hear that in reading this. Mm-hmm. You know, and you know, it's a struggle. In fact, I'll tell you a little bit more. The person who wanted me to read this book wanted me to start a group that she could do, because she did not want to do a regular 12-step group, because she did not want to identify as an addict. And I was like, and as I'm reading this, I said, well, you don't want to identify as addict, but in the very first step, we have to give up all control. So what's the problem, you know? I mean, if we're going to go there, who cares whether you say you can't stop or not, you know? So it's interesting. I mean, in other words, there's a struggle there to admit that you have no control.
Right.
But you have to have some. I mean, that's what this is about.
Yeah,
right.
And this is
can't
a,
renounce.
This, yes, this is a, some way to resolve, I think, those two, like you were saying.
Right, and that's, you know, in the course of, we're going to bring this, in a way, to questions of ritual, which are about controlling the uncontrollable.
Yeah.
Or
what
finding
can
a channel for the uncontrollable to flow. Yeah. Somebody has a question.
I do.
Yeah.
Well, I wonder, I can't believe I'm saying this. I want to go back to the language I never said. But I'm thinking from Paul's question again, we vow with all beings from this life on throughout countless lives. The first thing is to hear
of ritual as an aspect of vow. And this afternoon, because Adam's Jukai is coming up, so I think that if we together look at the Jukai ceremony, there are a lot of the elements of ritual that we can see as independent and interdependent in that ceremony. So today I'd like to kind of talk through the ceremony and the various pieces of it, and then tomorrow I think we're going to go into the Zendo, possibly in the morning, for sure in the afternoon. In the morning, talk about the Zendo as a... Are you ready? Okay. Good morning.
Good morning.
As I said yesterday, what I'd like to do over the next few days is begin by talking about the vow. Talking about vow and then ritual, looking at building blocks of ritual, at least in the Soto tradition, and looking at ritual itself in a broad way, and I think that's partly what we'll talk about today, considering repentance as a as an aspect of sacred space, and what are the things that are in the Zendo? What is it that wakes us up to the fact that it's a sacred space? What does that mean? What does sacred mean to us? And by looking at that, over the long term, what I'd like you to think of is like, how do we create and carry around that space with us? And then tomorrow afternoon, we can actually start pieces of rehearsal towards the ceremony. Does that make sense? Good. So where I'd like to begin, you've been sort of dipping in and out of living by vow, right? And somebody may have done this. You don't have to get very far into the book to, let's see, yeah, page, it's the first page of the preface. So Shohaku-san is talking about the temple, Katagiri Roshi's temple, Minnesota Zen Meditation Center on Lake Calhoun, which is called Koan-zan Ganshoji. Koan-zan means cultivating the clouds. It's a mountain. Zan is the mountain.